Listening to David Lammy there, what did you make of that? He sounds optimistic.
He does, cautiously. So I believe everybody is cautious. And the reason why everybody is cautious is where Mr. Lammy is, Israel, Netanyahu. All ducks are allied. You've seen, you've heard from the world, there was a Security Council resolution already. There was a Biden initiative in late May for a ceasefire. Hamas has expressed its positive response. The mediators, including Qatar and Egypt, together with the U.S., has been at it for some time. And the world has followed that Netanyahu has all along maneuvered, changed the goalpost. So we need sufficient pressure on Netanyahu to actually deliver what the world has a consensus on. And that's why the visit of the British and the French foreign secretaries is absolutely important, timely and historic. And we literally wish them success, because nothing is needed now more than stopping this carnage, this madness. And if it's not stopped now, after all the sheer suffering, all that happened over the course of 11 months, and with all the dynamics that you've just mentioned, stopping a regional war that I believe Netanyahu was instigating, if it doesn't happen, then we are into a new arena that will be a lose-lose for everybody. So let's hope, let's pray, let's work together that later today we will hear good news and the world has managed to finally rein in the unhinged Netanyahu and Israel.
Do you feel that could happen today?
It could happen if the world not only does the talk, but also do the walk. And the walk requires action, not just words and statements and sympathies. And Netanyahu will only listen if he believes action is to be followed. And action requires creating a leverage with him, a real leverage with him. And the leverage does not come by just carrots and more carrots.
What are you suggesting that would be?
That would have to include that, you know, we cannot continue providing you with the weapons that end up killing thousands of children. This is illegal. These are war crimes. And countries who provide Israel with such weapons are complicit, not according to what am I saying, Rosie. This is the ruling of the International Court of Justice and the International Criminal Court. So the legal side is very clear. What needs to happen is that he realizes that there are international actions and consequences. Last night, there was an Israeli settler rampage in a village near Nablus called Jet. Mm. Where they killed a Palestinian young person, and they set fire on homes, cars. It was literally terrorism. And this is a state-sponsored terrorism. So the world need to impose sanctions, as did the previous British government, by the way. David Cameron imposed sanctions on settlers and the settlement ecosystem. So these actions, and there are more actions, the recognition of the state of Palestine, as did Spain, Norway, Ireland, and many other countries of late. There are certain actions that Netanyahu will realize he has no option but to abide by and respect international legitimacy and international consensus.
I mean, Netanyahu has been fairly defiant up until this point and is willing to do so to the face of Joe Biden and presumably to David Lammy, our foreign secretary as well, and our prime minister, Keir Starmer. You talk about breaches of international law there. Presumably, you want both sides to be held accountable to the standard of international law, and that would be the leaders of Hamas as well.
That's why the state of Palestine has immediately, once it was recognized as a state in the UN system, acceded to the Rome Statute and officially sent a letter in 2014 already, you're talking about 10 years ago, to the ICC and all international judicial institutions that the state of Palestine calls on you to investigate all war crimes committed in the land of the state of Palestine, the occupied land of the state of Palestine. But guess what, Rosie? Since then, who has been blocking us? It's Netanyahu, it's Israel, calling that anti-Semitic, not wanting to cooperate with the international system, and Israel's backers, including often the UK government and of course the US administration, always blocking the application, the equal application of international law on everybody. So yes, Rosie, we want to see the equal application of international legality on everybody, and whatever the ICC comes up with, we will adhere to.
What we can't get away from is this renewed violence that started in October was triggered by the actions of Hamas.
The question here is, does all that happened since then justify that? Do you think the murder of more than 15 children justifies that? Only yesterday, the heartbreaking image of a father who went out to get the birth certificate of his twin, coming back to their apartment, finding that his twin, newborn only 2 days ago, together with their mother and the grandmother, are slaughtered, killed by an Israeli airstrike on their safe area, supposedly safe area. So, referring back always to the 7th of October makes it sound like, A, Palestinians are not allowed to talk about their grievances, that the 7th of October happened in vacuum, that we dare, and I had to face all this all along, we dare speak about our pain, our suffering, and what has been taking place for 76 years and counting.
Yeah, I've been decades long. So we're talking about what happened in the last year. And I know you've got family, friends in Gaza. We understand that this is sort of a deeply rooted, painful conflict. What we are searching for now in these talks is some kind of solution, some kind of glimmer of it. But Israel will say we need to completely obliterate Hamas. Do you think it's possible to do that?
Two wrongs does not make a right. It doesn't. And what Israel has done since the 7th of October, what Israel has done before the 7th of October, this whole system of oppression, occupation, colonization, apartheid, besiegement, the supremacy that we have suffered from for all these years. I wish, Rosie, if you hadn't gone, go and see the situation there. This is the last remaining collective punishment and a situation of mass subjugation in the 21st century. So...
But do you think it's possible to obliterate Hamas? And is there a way to do it which doesn't have civilian casualties?
If you think Hamas or Fatah or any political faction is the cause of the conflict, think again, Rosie. They are the outcome. They are the product of the conflict. What we need to focus on is the root cause of all this. Because, you know, even if Hamas or any other Palestinian political faction is gone, like many before, new ones will come out. So long as people are caged,
but does that mean there isn't an effort?
Are deprived of their very basic birthrights of equality before the law, of freedom, of dignity. They will keep producing political factions. So what is this? We are looking at the symptoms. We are not focusing on the root cause. So all of a sudden now it's Hamas, Hamas. Before it was the PLO, PLO. Remember? So nobody is really trying to focus on this. And this is the moment. This is the moment. We don't just reach a ceasefire as if this is the achievement. This is nothing. We achieve a ceasefire because what happened over the last 11 months is a travesty, is a dent in our humanity. It must stop. But we move swiftly from a ceasefire towards really addressing the root causes. And the root causes are very well known. Israel has got to be out.
But the immediate conversation that they're having now.
Did you read the ruling of the International Court of Justice?
Let's just talk about what's happening.
That's the highest court of the globe. Did you see it, Rosie?
Let me just, Husam, for 1 second. The conversation that we're having now is trying to deal with what's happening now in the immediate. And then definitely there has got to be conversation about what the long-term solution for this is. Just from a personal level, because I think people hear conversations like this and they feel despair, and you must as well feel this and think, where can we possibly find an area where there can be agreement when there is so much pain and hurt on both sides? Just from a personal perspective, tell us, your job's changed dramatically in the last 10 months. You must just be feeling that this is, I don't know, hope? Do you feel that there's a chance that this improves and it does in a way that's peaceful, which means no more lives are lost on either side?
I do feel a sense of hope, yes. I feel it because our people have proven yet again that they will go on struggling for their very legitimate rights, internationally granted rights. I feel hope because of the international public opinion, and particularly here in the UK. I mean, the last 11 months have seen the level of support, of solidarity. This is inspiring in every sense. And I feel a sense of hope because there is such a clarity in international legality. When we go to the International Court of Justice, You see, the legality side is very important. We have wasted so much time in discussing politics. First, we have
Politics is important because here we've got a whole new government. The situation in the last 6 weeks has changed quite materially. Does that change things for you?
But even politics has got to be played according to some certain rules and references. If we don't have that, then we are in the rule of the jungle.
But and that's here exactly in the UK, what we had you're not suggesting that David Lammy and Keir Starmer aren't abiding by rules. Do you feel more optimistic now we've got a new government in place here?
I feel more optimistic that many governments, including the new Labour government, is closer to and more committed to international legality than previous governments. Yes, that's why the first thing they did was to actually withdraw the intervention at the ICC. For, you know, the previous government asked for the ICC not to issue arrest warrants against Netanyahu and Gallant, but the new government said, we fully respect international legality and the independence of the ICC. They have taken some steps towards reviewing the arms trade issue, and they have resumed funding for UNRWA. UNRWA is an international UN organization. So all this indicates that the new government is more committed to international legality. Yes, indeed. And that's exactly what we are saying. All what we say, linking to your first question, the rule of the law. That's it. Rule of the law has got to be applied on me, on you, on the Israelis, and on everybody. Enough. We have got to end almost a century of Israel being, and before that, since the Balfour Declaration, and since its foundation in 1948, being above the law, that is Israel, having full impunity by the West. Israel has got to be beneath the law, under the law, and everybody else. And I believe if we truly, truly begin with applying the rule of law, we have a chance in the political arena. Before that, the political arena is a reflection of might is right.
Should Hamas come to these negotiations?
The Palestinians have their national institutions. They're legitimate national institutions that represent the entire Palestinian people and negotiate on their behalf.
That's sufficient?
That is the PLO, the Palestine Liberation Organization. And we have a Palestinian national government. We have 149 countries fully recognizing the state of Palestine. We have a seat in the UN system. So the state of Palestine and the PLO would be negotiating on the Palestinian people, as has been the case all along. We have no issue of leadership. This is not an issue of reform or whatever. Needed it is. This is an issue of accepting the legitimate rights of the Palestinian people and acting on it now, not in a distant future.
Husam Zomlot, I think you've put the case ahead. Thank you very much. The Palestinian ambassador to the